this morning, there are so many people trying to find life in so many other places other than Jesus. And I just want you to know, it's kind of like trying to put that round dowel pin in a square hole. It doesn't matter what you're going to do. If you're trying to find life anywhere other than in Jesus, you're never going to succeed. And so with this morning, I want to go on like we did last week. I want to encourage you to stand and honor the reading of God's word. Matthew 19, verses 16 and following. Scripture says this: "And behold, a man came up to Jesus, saying, 'Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?'" I want you to hang on to that question. What good deed must I do to have eternal life? "And he said to him, 'Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments.'" Jesus was now responding to the individual who came up to him, and he said, "If you would enter into life, keep the commandments." And he said, "Which ones?" Jesus said, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said, "All these I have kept. What do I still lack?" In other words, he's like, "I've done all of these, but I still feel like there's something missing." This is what the young man was saying to Jesus. He says, "I have done all of those things, but what do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you would be perfect, go sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come and follow me." When the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Truly I say to you, only with difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven. Again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, saying, "Who then can be saved?" But Jesus looked at them and he said, "With man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." Will you pray with me this morning? Father, just ask right now you would just help us to get our hearts right. Lord, help me get my heart right. I pray if there's anything that I've kept from you, if there's any burden on my soul, if there's any sin in my life that I've yet to confess, I pray that you would lay that on my heart right now, that I might lay it at your feet. Father, I pray for an anointing. I pray that you would use me as a living vessel, that your word would go forth and not return void, but that it would do everything you intend for it to do. I pray that if there's even one person who watches our service today, who joins us, pray that if there's even one who is lost, who is broken, who needs to repent and trust Jesus, that today would be the day of salvation. Father, I pray those who are hurting, those who are mourning, those who are broken, those who are already your children, those who belong to you because of the precious blood of Jesus, that you remind them that they have everything they need in you. Father, today we love you. We praise you. We thank you for loving us the way you do. In Jesus' name, amen. I think the excitement of this particular verse, these particular verses this morning, is simply because of the time we're living in right now, and we're simply trying to get by. We're trying to live our lives the very best we can. I remember there was a time for a lot of us where we were out chasing the American dream. We were doing everything we could to attain that higher status. We wanted to go just one step further, just one more accomplishment in life. And we were running the race, and we were doing everything we could do in order to achieve the goals we had set for ourselves. The problem with that is our eye was never on God. Our eye was always on ourselves and our next accomplishment or achievement. And I want to tell you, according to the scripture, and I believe this with all of my heart, is that we fall miserably short if we try and do anything in life without having our eyes fixed completely and totally on Jesus, who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Oh, church, I pray today that we would be able to keep our eyes focused on the one who has died for our sins and who rose 3 days later. Oh, church, that we would keep our eyes fixed on our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Really, there are four things that I want to share with you today, and I want you to write those down. I want you to remember what these steps are today to assure yourself that you have that eternal life, that you're able to enter into the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, when this life is over, when you breathe your last. And so the first thing that I want to share with you is this, and that just listen, because you know this statement is true. Everyone is on a quest to find eternal life. I hear people talking throughout my ministry, and I listen to them, and I've even been asked this question, "Preacher, what must I do to be saved?" Just like Jesus was asked, "What must I do to have eternal life?" What a bold question that was for this rich young man to run up to Jesus and boldly ask him, "What do I need to do in order to have eternal life?" That's a question for the ages. There are so many people who are out in this world and they're looking for ways to have eternal life. We're trying to be more youthful. We're trying to, whatever concoction we can, the more exercise we can do, the better our heart will be, or the more weight we'll lose, the longer we'll live. And I think that's fantastic. You should do those things. You should pursue health. But I can tell you, according to the Word of God, there is a time, according to Scripture, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, for everything under the sun, including a time for your heart to beat its very last beat. And Solomon even said in Ecclesiastes that all is vanity. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity, that we're pursuing after the sun, never to reach it, never to attain the goals and the hopes and the dreams that we're really searching for. And by the time we climb up the one step a little bit higher on the ladder of success, we fix our eyes on the next thing we want to accomplish for ourselves. I want to tell you something. I'm so done with trying to do things my way. Now the only thing I want to do is glorify my Savior. Now the only thing I want to do is make His name great. The only thing that I want to do is preach Jesus to as many people as I can share about the Word of God, the one who died on the cross, the one who was buried in a borrowed tomb, the one who was raised 3 days later, the one who sits at the right hand of the Father in heaven, mediating on your behalf today. Everyone is on a quest to find eternal life. Let me ask you, have you been on that quest? I would say the answer is probably yes. You've been on that quest. You really want to know what's next, what comes after this life is over. And I can assure you, this life will end one way or another. And so everyone is on this quest. This rich young ruler, he was on a quest. Jesus said, a man came up to him saying, "Teacher," this is what the young man said, "Teacher, what good deed must I do in order to have eternal life?" He thought eternal life was going to be accomplished by doing something next. What next? What else? What more can I do? What is it that's missing in my life? How else can I be a servant? What else can I do to help somebody? How else can I keep the commandments in order to be obedient to your word? And so Jesus goes on this dialogue, this narrative with this young man. But I want to share with you, there's two words in the New Testament that deal with life. One of them, you know, is bios. That's the word. You and I know it from the word biology. That's where we get that word, and it literally means physical life, but very rarely in the New Testament is this particular word used, bios. Physical life, the life you and I have in the flesh. More times than not, about 143 times in the New Testament, the word for life is used that is Zoe. Zoe is talking about the abundant life. Now, I'm not talking about life abundantly lived in the flesh. I'm talking about life abundantly lived in the spirit, pursuing the things that God has called you to pursue. It's about experiencing the joys of life. So this Zoe, the abundant life. And so many Christians misunderstand the term eternal life. And I want to squash that for you this morning. I want you to get past that. I want you to understand if you ask the average Christian to define what eternal life is, most of them are going to say it's to be able to live forever. And then to ask, when does eternal life start? If you were to ask someone that, church, when does eternal life start? In 99% of the people you ask, even in the church, say when you die, when you breathe your last this side of heaven. But I want you to know that's not at all true. When life really begins for you and I as Christ followers, when we understand that we're really going to live forever, it starts when you meet Jesus. When does eternal life really begin? Eternal life for the Christ follower begins when you say yes to Jesus. Come on, church. How about someone saying yes to Jesus today? How about someone being introduced to Jesus maybe for the very first time and them repenting of their sin? Because according to Scripture, we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God, every one of us. I know I'm a sinner. And if it were not for the precious blood of Jesus, then I'd be lost in my trespasses and sin. But I'm not. I am the righteousness of God because of Christ Jesus, my Lord. And so I want to share with you, John chapter 10, verse 10 says this, talking about life. Jesus said, I have come that you may have life, Zoe, the abundant life, the eternal life, the spiritual life, where you are forever in the presence of King Jesus, your Savior. I have come that you might have life and that you might have it to the full. This is what our Savior wants for us more than anything else. He wants us to experience the abundant life, and He doesn't want you to wait until you get to heaven to experience the joys of knowing Jesus as your Savior. He wants you to experience the abundant life today. He wants you to experience life in Jesus today, the abundant life, not the bios, not this physical world that we live in, but that spiritual, that connection between you and the Father. So this rich young man, he did so many things right. He was obedient in so many areas. He came at the right time, and then he asked Jesus. He came with the right attitude. He was running. He was kneeling down. He was sincere in his request. He was seeking the right thing. He was seeking eternal life. And mainly, he came to the right source. He came to Jesus. But he came with the wrong understanding of what eternal life was. And so he asked the question. He walked away at the end of their conversation, and I just wonder why. Why did this young man walk away the way he did? And so the rest of the text talks about this. We're going to look at that. And so the first thing is this. Everyone is on a quest for eternal life. And the second thing is that there is only room for one God in your life. I don't have to make this stuff up, church. This is what the Scripture teaches. Listen to verses 17 and following. And he said to him, why do you ask me about what is good? This is Jesus now responding to the young man. Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. And so now Jesus is talking about God the Father. And so he says, if you would enter Zoe, if you would enter into the abundant life. He already had the possessions of the world, and there was still something missing. And so he said, if you would enter life, keep the commandments. Now, you need to understand what Jesus was doing here. He was trying to get his attention. He was trying to help him see that there's so much more to life than meets the eye, including a set of rules. But the young man said this, he asked the question, which ones? And so Jesus said, you know, there's 10 commandments, there's two sets. When Moses went up on the mountain and he received the word of God, there was two stone tablets. And each one of those stone tablets had a set of commandments that God had given Moses for the children of Israel when he came down the mountain. And they were to follow these rules. And he didn't start with the first commandment. Jesus did not start with the first side of the commandment tablets. He started with the second side of the commandment tablets. And he said this, "You shall not murder." Pretty easy one, isn't it? I mean, it's not something that I want to do. I don't want to murder anyone. I don't want to take someone's life. I want to give life. I want to share Jesus with them. And so he said, "You shall not murder." Then he goes on and said, "You shall not commit adultery." This is another one of those rules. And it's important that we follow these rules because they are given as God's commandments to us. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not lie against someone else. And then he said, "You are to honor your father and your mother." I mean, these are what the scripture says here, and these are what the commandments are. You shall honor your father and mother. And then he says this, "And you shall also love your neighbor as yourself." And so Jesus, being a teacher, always trying to get his creation to see the big picture. He was painting this picture for the young man, and I almost think some of his humorous personality was coming out in this as well. Well, you don't do this, and you don't do that, and you don't do this, and this is these set of rules that you're supposed to follow. And you know, according to the Old Testament, there are 633 rules. About half of them are positive. These are things you're supposed to do. And the other half of those 630 plus rules are negative. These are things you're not supposed to do. And so he cropped it down to these 10, and he was sharing with him about these. And the young man said to him, "All these things I've done." I've done every one of these. I've followed the commandments, everything that you've just stated. I have done every single one of them. I have not murdered. I have not committed adultery. I have not stolen. I have not bared false witness towards someone. I have honored my father and mother, and I love my neighbor as myself. The rich young man said, "I've done all of these things." But there was still something missing right here, and he sensed that. And he said, "What do I still lack?" He knew that there was still a big hole there in his heart. He knew that there was still something missing. He knew that he wasn't doing something right. And so Jesus had gotten his attention now. And I just think in our lives, this is what he does. He gets our attention. And what you need to know, church, is there is only room for one God in your life. You cannot continue to pursue after the things of the world and please God with your life. Yes, God wants you to be blessed. Yes, God wants you to have things. Yes, God wants you to experience life in this earth, in the physical. But more than anything, he wants you to experience the abundant life in knowing his son, Jesus, as your Lord and Savior. And until you get there, church, listen to me. Until you get there, lost soul, until you get there, person who has never said yes to Jesus, until you get there, you will never experience the abundant life you search for, you long for. Oh, what do I still lack? Is there any of you joining us today who is questioning right now, "Lord, I just feel like there's a big hole. I feel like there's something that's lacking. So what else do I need to do?" And you're trying to make it about you again. And so, "All these things I have kept, what do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you would be perfect, if you want to be complete in your pursuit of God," so listen to this next section of scripture. This is important. This is very, very important. Listen, Jesus said to him, "If you would be perfect, go sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven." All right, that was the first part of it. I need you to go get rid of everything you have. You've put all of your faith in the possessions that you have, and that's the one thing that's keeping you from pursuing the righteousness of God. And so he's saying, I need you to go get rid of everything that's in your possession. Get rid of it all. Give it to the poor. And then he said, and you'll have treasure in heaven. But then he says something that was truly life-changing. He said, come and follow me. See, this is where eternal life really steps in for you and I. It's about our pursuit of God the Creator through His Son, Jesus. Come and follow Him. Will you be someone who is passionately pursuing the Creator through His Son, Jesus? Are you one of those who will follow? Are you following with everything that you have? Are you willing to surrender everything in order to follow Jesus? What is it you're missing? What is it that's lacking right now from you truly experiencing real joy? There's only room for one God in your life. And so the scripture goes on and it says, when the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. He bowed his head, he hung his head in protest almost. He hung his head in shame. He hung his head in pursuit not of God, but he did not want to release the things that he had. He did not really understand that eternal life was so much more important than the here and now. He didn't quite get it, even though Jesus said, go sell everything you have and then come and follow me. He just wasn't willing to do that. It's about complete surrender. So as I preach this message today, I just wonder with you who are watching, you who are listening, is there any one of you who needs to surrender everything you have to the Lordship of Jesus? Yes. I have to do this every day of my life. I have to surrender everything I have. Lord, this is yours here. Do with it as you will. The things God has given you are tools to be used to bring glory to Him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. They are tools to be used in order to share the gospel of Jesus. They are tools to be used to love your neighbor as yourself. They are tools to be used in order to honor God with your life. That's what this life is about. Finding the things that He has blessed you with and trying to figure out ways to use them for His honor and His glory. The rich young ruler wasn't quite willing to do that. He didn't want to surrender those things. He didn't want to give it up. He wanted to hang on to those things that he had because he had many possessions. Great possessions is what the scripture says. I want to step on a few toes, church, because according to what's going on in the world, you and I in the United States are 95% more wealthy than the rest of the people of the world. Let that sink in. Even those who don't have a lot, they have roofs over their head mostly. Even those who don't have a lot, they have food on their table. Even if you don't have food in your refrigerator, there's soup kitchen here every Wednesday and Saturday where you can come and get food. There are grocery banks all across the city and the state where you can find food for yourself. You can find something to eat somewhere. You are blessed. And so you and I are absolutely more wealthy than most of the people of the world. And so Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, I want you to listen. He said, no one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Church, you've got to decide that. You've got to make your mind up. Are you going to continue to pursue the things of the world, or are you going to surrender everything you have? God, I don't care what it takes. I'm willing to surrender it all because all I want is to know you more. Can you say that this morning, church? Church, can you say that all I want to do is know Jesus more? And if it means forfeiting everything you have in order to follow Jesus, then are you willing to forfeit everything in order to follow Jesus? Or are you willing to try and figure out a way to take the things God has given you and glorify Him with the possessions you have? God, you've given me this, and I just want to point people to Jesus every way that I can through the things you've given me, the things you've blessed me with. And so the second thing is, there is only room for one God in your life. Do you get that? Church, do you get that? There's only room for one God in your life. And the third thing, we're going to move on. Third thing that I want to share to you is this. It's impossible for a rich person to earn salvation. So let me get this right for you. I shared with you already that we are wealthier, more wealthy than 95% of the people around the world. The 95% of the people around the world, you and I are more wealthy than 95% of the people around the world. And so I need you to understand that it's impossible for a rich person, it's impossible for any person to earn salvation. See, this young ruler was trying to make it about the thing, what must I do? What else do I need to do? How else can I serve? What else do I need to give? How else can I assure myself that I'm going to enter eternal life? What else do I need to do in order to know that I am saved beyond a shadow of a doubt, because I want to have eternal life? I want to share something with you this morning. You've got eternal life already, but you're going to either spend it by default outside of the gates of heaven because you've never repented and trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, or you will repent of your sin and you will spend an eternity in the presence of God because of the blood of Jesus Christ. So you'll either say yes to Jesus and have eternal life in His presence, or you'll say no to Jesus and you'll have eternal life separated from God the Creator, eternally damned to hell fire. Yes, it is a real place of torment and torture where you will spend eternity. And now you're thinking, but why would God allow us to experience that kind of torment and torture for eternity? Well, see, that's not what God wants. God surrendered everything. God sent His Son. He sacrificed the one He loved for your sin. He sacrificed the one He loved for my sin. And you and I are able to love only because He first loved us. And so we think about the Scripture and we know what it says. And listen to verse 23 and 24. And Jesus said to the disciples, "Truly I say to you, only with difficulty will a rich person enter the kingdom of heaven." Only with difficulty. To surrender it all. To be willing to sacrifice everything for the glory of the one who created you. To willing to give it all up because you know there are treasures in heaven that you will receive where you will spend eternity. This abundant life, this Zoe life, is what He desires for you to experience. And that begins the moment you meet Jesus. The moment you say no to self and yes to Jesus. It's not difficult. And so it's impossible for this rich person or any person to earn salvation. Listen to what He said in verse 24 again, "I tell you." So this must be a statement Jesus had made at some other time. He said in verse 24, "It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." Now somewhere along the line, people tried to take this verse and make it mean something a little bit differently than I think what was intended. So you think about it. There are some who said that there were gates in Jerusalem, or there was a worship center, a sanctuary in Jerusalem, or a temple in Jerusalem where there was this really, really low gate or this really, really low wall where a camel would be able to come in and duck its head and bend its knees and crawl underneath this. Like it would be head height for most people, and you're just to walk into those things. See, but according to history, there's really nothing that gives credence to that. But what it is talking about, there's two words in the Greek that are used for needle. And both of these words literally are talking about something you sew with. Both words deal with something you sew with. So how possible is it for a camel to go through the eye of a needle where you thread the thread and pull it in order to stitch something that has been torn? What are the chances that this 3,000-pound animal are going to be able to go through the eye of that needle? Zero. It's impossible. It's never going to happen. It's impossible. It's impossible for the rich person. And this is, listen, I'm not trying to make any, if you're wealthy, praise God for that. But you need to make sure you are following after, coming after, running after the one who died for your sins and rose 3 days later. You need to make sure you're following full force in pursuit of King Jesus. So he says this in verse 24. And again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter into the kingdom of God. Can you imagine the heartache this young man must have experienced? Because according to the text, he had great possessions. He had great wealth. It sounds like he had everything he wanted. He is the Bill Gates of his world. He had it all. He had everything. And so he didn't need anything else. Verse 25 and 26, the last thing that I want to share with you is this. You and I, we have hope because God specializes in the impossible. This is what Jesus was teaching. There's hope. It's nothing that you can do in order to earn your salvation. It was nothing this young man could do in order to inherit. He still lacked something. It didn't matter if he had kept all of the commandments. It didn't make any difference if he had done, given everything he had away. If he still wasn't willing to follow Jesus, come after Jesus, surrendering it all and following Jesus, he was still going to be lost in his trespasses and sin. And so you've got to understand what the text says right here. When the disciples heard this, verse 25 says, when the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, saying, "Who then can be saved?" Church, that is the question of the day. Then who can be saved? And so I want to tell you, it's not something I need to make up. This is what Jesus said to the disciples. Jesus looked at them, and I can only imagine the intensity, the passion, the brokenness, but also the love with which Jesus looked into the eyes of the disciples. But Jesus looked at them and said, "With man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible." And so you need to stop trying to think there's something that you're going to do to inherit the kingdom of God. See, God the Father sent his Son to die. Is the ultimate, the propitiation for our sins. He came, became the eternal sacrifice, the one, the perfect spotless lamb whose blood was shed, the perfect spotless blood was shed to cover sins once for all. And so now what you have to do is you have to be willing to repent of your sin and trust Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life. The scripture tells us, and you know this scripture, John 3:16, "For God so loved the world." What did he do, church? He gave He sacrificed his one and only son that whoever would believe in him would have eternal life. This is the hope for you, and this is the hope for me. You'll never earn your salvation, but you can experience it by knowing Jesus Christ as your Savior. And so I'm going to conclude this morning with making a statement that I started with. It's the title of the sermon. Life begins with Jesus. Do you want to know how you can experience eternal life? Sacrifice everything you have. Pretend as though it doesn't matter, because you need to be fully in pursuit of King Jesus. Surrender everything to him and come after Jesus. Church, he's already come after you. Lost soul, he's already come after you. He is alive. He is well. He is at the right hand of the Father in heaven, and he is waiting for you to say yes to Jesus. Will you do that today? I'm going to tell you what we're going to do. I want to give you an opportunity to respond today. If you're ready to experience this eternal life, this Zoe, the abundant life, this Zoe life, and you've never repented and trusted Jesus as your Savior, I want you to say yes in the comment section. Or I want you to give me a high five in the comment section. Or I want you to put these praying hands in the comment section. Or a thumbs up in the comment section. Let me know that today you are saying yes to Jesus. Because that's what it takes to have eternal life. It's to repent. It's to turn from the way you were living. If this young man would have just turned from the way he was living and said yes to Jesus, he would have experienced eternal life in the kingdom of God. What must I do to be saved? What must I do to inherit, to receive eternal life? Repent and believe on Jesus as your Savior. Pray with me. Father in heaven, this morning, Lord, we just humble our hearts in your presence. And we think about for just a moment the reality that there are people every single day who are dying and going to hell. Father, they've forsaken your son Jesus. They've said no to surrendering everything they have to him. And as a result, they breathe their last on this earth, and they enter into their eternal damnation. Father, I pray that today somebody would get it right. I pray that today somebody would say yes to Jesus. I pray that somebody would be willing to surrender everything they are in pursuit of the one who died for them. Today, Father, I pray, I beg you in the strong name of Jesus, that today would be the day of salvation for someone who is far from you. Father, we're going to have this invitation. Caitlin is going to lead us, and I pray that someone would just remark yes to Jesus, that someone would give us a high five or a thumbs up and say yes to Jesus. Lord, that someone would put on the comment section, yes to Jesus today, so that we'll know that they are eternally yours. Father, we praise you today for what you've done and for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, will you stand this morning?
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing, mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, hero. rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Amen. Thank you, Caitlin. Amen. That concludes our service this morning. I know we've had some technical difficulties. I think still the mic wasn't working this morning, and I apologize for that. Prayerfully, we'll get those kinks worked out. But we love you guys, and we will see you again soon. God bless.